Sisters, saints, and friends, welcome to Hill City, the best church in the entire world. Ain't that right, brethren?
Yeah. Yeah.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Lock in with us. This is not your ordinary service. I know you're used to an ordinary service, but this is not your ordinary service. We're doing something extraordinary today. We're going to have a real discussion, man-to-man talk about the issues that are happening in our culture right now. Just over the last few weeks, we've seen some crazy things unfold in our culture, and we need to talk about it. We don't need to shy away from it. Let's talk about what's going on right now, all right? So let's lock in, because I've seen how the enemy have brought destruction and waging war against our people, waging war against our black brothers, waging war against our black fathers and our black sons. You hear me? So today, we're going to dedicate this entire hour to have the tough discussion about the state of the black man in America. Come on, it's not easy being black on these grounds. So we have to be in the fight and protest against the evil that the enemy is trying to present to us in this generation. So lock in with me. Fathers, get your sons, set them right down so they can hear us right now, because we're going to have real conversations. We even asked an officer to come and speak to us and talk to us how to navigate through all this chaos that's going on right now. All right? So brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it. It's man-to-man talk, the state of the black man in America. Right here is Hill City Church. Lock in with me. Let's go. Make some noise, y'all. Let's go. Let me say happy Father's Day to all the brethren out there. All the men that are taking responsibility and taking the lead in your home. This song is for you.
Things are moving fast. me free.
Follow me right there. Take it from me, Seth.
Take it from me tonight.
Yeah.
Take it from me tonight. Tonight. Take it from me tonight.
Listen, I speak blessing and favor today. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Of course, today we have dedicated this time to uplift our men and to educate our men. And first of all, let's say happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there that are taking the responsibility to lead your family and to protect your family and cover your family, feed your family. You are to be commended. First of all, let me just say, I got to give a shout out to Bishop Haddon. You did a great job, man. Look at me now. Look, I'm a good man, all right? It's because you did your job, all right? Also want to give a shout out to my biological father. He had it tough, and he couldn't be the father that he wanted to be because he was in the Army. He dealt with some things, with Agent Orange, and those of you that may know anything about that, he had PTSD. I want to give a shout out to my biological father, Gerald Troop. God bless you. God bless you, Gerald Troop. All right, but we have fathers here with us right now. We see generations right here, right now. And we're going to open the floor to the brothers and the sons to be able to share something to tribute to their father or son for Father's Day.
Yes, I have something I'd like to say.
Yes, sir. You got the floor, LeVar.
I'm grateful for my dad. He didn't quite raise me, but I'm still appreciative of him. But I'm also grateful to be a father to a son. I have three sons. I'm a girl dad also, but I have three sons, and I'm grateful to have three sons to be able to break that chain and be able to be the man in their lives. Yeah. So happy Father's Day.
Incredible. Right on point.
Go ahead, Jamal. You got the floor.
All right, I have something to say. I didn't have my dad in my life. I grew up without a father, but I want to break the cycle for all you dads out there that didn't have a dad in your life, and you have a son. Break the cycle. Raise up your son to be the best man he could possibly be in this earth. Amen.
Did little man want to say something?
Happy Father's Day, and you're the best dad in the world.
Anybody else before we move on?
Yeah, I got something to say. Happy Father's Day to my father as he rests in peace. I lost him in 2015, but I am still blessed to be a father myself of a daughter as well as my son right here. You know, happy Father's Day to all of the fathers, all of the mans that's going to become a father. Deitrick, you know, like a father figure to me as well. So thank you guys. I'm just grateful to be a father and be able to break curses and generational curses of my father not being in my life and being able to be a primary factor even in my son's life. So I'm just happy to be the man that God has allowed me to be to show him how to be a man in today's world and to help him maneuver through the channels and the obstacles that us as black mans and mans is going to face today in this life and even in the future. So thank you.
I just want to say happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there and to all the fathers that people, you know, that been missing their fathers back then until now. And I just want to say happy Father's Day to you. He's been, you know, helping me talk and try to build as being a man. And I just want to say he gave me a lot of support in this world, and I love him. I really do.
I happen to have six sons, so I can't wait to get to them to collect my presents. But I really want to say a shout out to Michelle's father, who's in the hospital, got out strong. We're looking to say something to him, and I want to say that for him, to her, for him. Happy Father's Day.
Amen. I am a father as well, and I wanted to say happy Father's Day to my dad, Reginald Walker, and my grandfather, Sonny Buford Walker. I'm not in my children's life, but I just want to encourage the ones that have a struggle with just being a part of their children's life to just stay strong, just know that your children do love you, and just continue to fight and love them the way you can.
I'd just like to say happy Father's Day to all the fathers. I'm a father of three sons, and I have 12 grandchildren. And I just very blessed because my father was in my life. He was tough, but he helped me to be the man that I am. And he also no nonsense type of a father. You know, the old type, hit you upside the head, kick you in the butt. But it was good because it kept me out of jail and kept me out of trouble. So I was blessed to have that. My father is rest in peace. He passed away like 15 years ago. But his influence is still on me today, and so I was kind of tough on my kids too. But hey, that's what we have to be. And my dad always told me, he says, you know what, son, you're black, you're gonna have to do better. And I never really understood that when I was little, but as I got to be older, I understood exactly what he meant. We have to make sure that we don't break the law at all. You have to be 100%. In everything that you do. If not, they're gonna always say, well, you know, it's like this guy that was shot here last week. They were saying that he fought with the police. So now they're looking for every excuse to say that this young man was guilty of being shot in the back, which that was not right. But we have to be 100% right as black men, and that's what I was taught, so. For all you young brothers that's in the room here now, this is something that we have to strive, and we need God to help us because you can't do it on your own.
Good talk, good talk. Somebody else?
I'm not a father, but I am a son. My father wasn't really in my life as much as he should have been, kind of in and out, but my mother stepped up to be that father figure that I needed, so she played both parts.
Wow.
Even within the church, I had father figures, worship leaders to look up to, and it really helped shape my life. With my mother playing both parts, it was kind of hard on her, but I tried to help her out as much as I could. Really, I just want to say for all the guys out there, all the young men that have only a mother, no father, maybe your father is in and out of your life, You'll be okay in the long run. As long as you keep pushing, keep moving forward towards your goals, you'll be all right.
Oh, that's really good. Really good. You say something, Dan?
Well, shout out to all the fathers. Happy Father's Day to everyone. And shout out to our pastor, and who's been a good pastor, a good friend, a good brother, who is like an ultimate father figure. I lost my father back in 2006. He was very powerful, very strong, no nonsense. You know, he'd just give you a look, and that was it. So I did learn a lot to carry on from that. I do miss him so much. So happy Father's Day.
Well, Father's Day is kind of bittersweet for me, but like I said, I lost my father like a couple others as well, but I know what it is to see my father. I know what it is to see my father struggle with drugs, and he came out of the streets, and a lot of people in the church pushed him out of the church and pushed him away from my mom. But I seen him fight his way back into my life when I was in middle school, so he won like my trust again. And I'm grateful to see someone like, you know, if for the fathers out there that feel like you can't come back, people push you away, you can come back to your family. It's never too late. You know, your sons will accept you back. And also, since my father passed away, I had a tough time, but I was blessed with Pastor Deitrick and now also Mickey as well. And I thank the Lord for giving me someone to hold me accountable even when I don't want to listen. So, blessings to every father, and to the sons, hey, you're going to make it. It's all good.
Wow, incredible. Fathers, listen, this is your day. Celebrate. Celebrate that man. Be strong. Be courageous. Continue to be brave. You mean something to somebody. And so, again, we want to say happy Father's Day to all the men. It seems like the theme here is breaking the cycle. I believe I'm breaking the cycle in my family lineage, and many of the men here, we're determined to break the cycle. So I commend all the brethren for breaking that cycle. I commend all the men that are watching us now for you breaking the cycle. Listen, just this week, there's been some things going on in our culture just this week, devastating things as it pertains to police brutality. And so we're here to have the real conversation, the tough conversation. We have asked Officer Antonio Graham to come and have that conversation with us. And he so readily agreed. So we're going to get into it. But before we do that, can I have Mickey come and introduce this song that he and I wrote together? It's called I Can't Breathe. Mickey, come on. I got to give credit where credit is due. Let's give Mickey Stevenson a hand. Mickey called me this week while I was asleep. Had to be 7 a.m. in the morning. I was like, what is he calling me for? What's going on? Something wrong. So I answered the phone and tell them what you told me on the phone.
That Whoopi Goldberg and her manager, they heard the song and said that we got to have this. And we'll have it in front of 2,500,000 people right away. And they said the song, Whoopi said the song just brought tears to her eyes. And the next thing I know, it was on. It was happening.
It was on The View, on the national TV show called The View on ABC, I believe. They aired it this week.
Yes.
And it was amazing how we wrote it. You know, I had a melody, and Mickey came over for a Sunday dinner, and he jumped right in and gave me the perfect lyrics for the song. I want to share it with you today. Can you just lock in for us, with us? Can you just lock in with us for a minute? Here's a brand new song called I Can't Breathe, and we'll move further into the conversation.
Today is Juneteenth, which honors the end of slavery in the U.S., which is why I want to start with a new song that brilliantly captures how much further we still need to go. Performed by Deitrick Haddon and written by Haddon and Mickey Stevenson, it's called I Can't Breathe. Take a look.
Brother's name was George, and he walked into the store because his money was low. They called him a criminal, and they called authorities. They put handcuffs on me, and when I tried to explain, they responded with the knee. I can't breathe. Your hate is choking the life out of me. This supposed to be the land of the free. Look at me. Just like you, I'm trying to raise my family. Remove your knee, 'cause I can't breathe. And we demand a change. We demand it right now. And the blood of the innocent is crying from the ground. 400 years of slavery, dream. When will reparations come? When will freedom ring? I can't breathe. Oh, your hatred is choking the life out of me. This supposed to be the land of the free, but look at me. Annapolis. San Francisco, people all over the world, from Africa to the UK.
City Church, listen, you guys are amazing. Amazing how we've been locking in. We are unified. Where other churches are all divided and scattered, you've been locked into the ministry. We've had 12 noon warfare class and midnight prayer every night. For the last, 60 days, 60-something days? Oh, more than 60 days. We've just been in prayer and staying locked in and learning together, praying together, and it's been a joy to serve as your pastor during this quarantine time. Now, soon we're coming out of quarantine. Tell your neighbor, we're coming out of this. We're coming out of this. Amen. You're coming out alive. You're coming out with more joy. You're coming out with more peace. You're coming out on the victory side in Jesus' name. Listen, now's the time for our moment of generosity. An old school church would say it's offering time. It's time to give. Now, listen, don't back up with your giving, because the Lord has called us to do something very great that I want to announce to you today. Soon we will be having something called Gospel Against Police Brutality. We'll have outdoor events where we will have voter registration, COVID-19 testing. We're partnering with the AIDS Healthcare Foundation. We'll have AIDS testing out there and giveaways and food, free food, and we will be having service outdoors. Get ready, Hill City Church. We're going to the highways and byways to declare that Jesus Christ is Lord and to protest against the powers that be in the name of Jesus. So, brothers and sisters, don't back up with your giving. What you give allow us to do these great things in the community. It allows us to be effective in ministry. And what you don't give causes us to be ineffective. So come on, we're a strong, effective church. Hill City Church matters. Just like Black Lives Matters, Hill City Church matter in this culture. So right now, I'm giving you the opportunity to give right now in Jesus' name. There are 5 ways you can give. Either way, it's received in Jesus' name. Let's say our confession together. Lord, we willingly and faithfully worship you with our giving through tithe and offering. We release our faith and finances so that all our ministry facilities will be built and our vision will be established in the earth. We believe that as we sow seed to establish the vision of your house, you will also establish ours. Therefore, as a result of our obedience and love in giving, we thank you, come on, for raises, increases, increased commissions, rebates, dividends, come on, canceled debt, and surprise checks in the mail. We bless you for blessing the health of our bodies, the sanity of our minds, and the quality of our relationships. We honor you for the divine favor that you bring to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my. But I know change gon' come. Oh, yes it will.
We're truly living in peerless times. And the Bible says, also says in Ecclesiastes, that there's a time and season for everything. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to have peace, a time for war. A time to be silent and a time to speak out. Well, today we're speaking out against the injustice in our culture. We dedicated this time to talk about the real issues and the state of the black man here in America. We have a man-to-man talk. Fellas, are y'all still with me?
Yeah.
So here to have the tough conversation, and y'all take it easy on him, okay? Take it easy on him. Is brother Antonio Graham. He is an officer here in the California area, and I asked him to come, and he readily agreed, and he is here to share with us, to educate us on how we can de-escalate some of these things that are taking place in our streets. Let's receive Brother Antonio by saying, yes, sir.
Just a little background on myself. My name is Antonio Graham. I've been born and raised in Detroit, Michigan.
All right.
313. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Born and raised in Detroit, Michigan. I went to the Marine Corps for 8 years, and then after that, I transitioned to law enforcement. I also have two sons, a 23-year-old and a 21-year-old. So I'm coming to you, just speaking to these issues and topics, not coming from just the position of law enforcement, but coming from the position of a black man
right,
who grew
right.
up in the inner city, who understood on the flip side of growing up in the inner city where the police weren't as friendly, they weren't cooperative. You know, I've been chased, I've been detained for things that I didn't do. I've been, you know, profiled that I felt at that particular time, and then I transitioned and went to school and became a law enforcement officer.
Wow.
So I have a diverse background, you know, been there, been on the other side of the coin as well. So I don't profess to know it all, but I've just given you a different perspective of where it comes from sitting in your position and sitting from my position.
Right.
Okay. And I also come in peace.
Oh.
All right.
Peace.
All right. So don't abuse me too much. We can talk a real talk man to man, you know, and we can just get to this thing and see if we can try to at least shed a little bit of light on what's going on in this country, and see if you can help better understand, because a lot of times the media push a lot of different things in narrative, but you don't see the perspective of a law enforcement officer.
Right.
So I want to give you that both perspective, and hopefully we can carve through this dichotomy of what's going on today.
I have the first question.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to just cut right to it.
Right.
Do you recognize that there is organized corruption in our police departments across the country? Do you see it? Do you recognize it?
That's a tough question.
It's a tough one.
You coming. Now, organized corruption is kind of a big gamut, you know, I can't say being an officer for 18 years, which I have been. I worked for three different departments. I was a reserve officer for one department. I worked for 3 years for another one, and now the current department that I work in Southern California, I've been there for 15 years. I have not seen where there has been a focus on doing anything illegal, immoral. The majority of the cops that I have worked with, worked for, have been in command with, have been in the streets and been in fights and everything, we all have a sense of pride of their job. Mm-hmm. And I've been with police officers that got the badge just to kind of be the macho, I'm a cop, I got this authority, right. Just to be real. I didn't like those guys because I come with a different perspective, being a man of God, being a Christian, also a pastor. So I come as a warrior of God. So
have you
hold myself to a different standard.
You haven't seen any backdoor conversations about, hey, we gonna do this and do that? You haven't heard anything in the back, in the locker room? You haven't felt anything that you felt like it's not right?
No, I haven't. I haven't. I know we want me to open up the big old pearl, but I haven't. You know, we try, especially this day and age now. I wasn't in law enforcement back in the 50s and 60s and all that stuff, where things where law enforcement has changed and evolved in so many different instances. It changed from, you know, Rodney King. It changed from,
right.
You know, all these different major incidents. It's changing with George Floyd, you know, rest
but
in peace.
But it's all happening at one time.
And it's all going throughout the years of the decade and all the change. So the reason why I became a police officer so I can make a difference in law enforcement, and I believe that I have. But it's definitely never, ever been, you know, honestly speaking, where it's a sought-out, we're just gonna do this, cover it up. You know, it's just never, ever, I've never had that sense in 18 years.
Well, I'm trying to make some sense of it here. Then why do you feel like it's happening all at one time? It's not just happening in one city with one group of people. It's happening everywhere. It's in Minneapolis, it's in Detroit, it's in Chicago. It feels like there's some kind of decree somewhere, like the president said, if they loot, shoot.
Right.
You know, it feels like it's happening on purpose everywhere all at one time.
And I see that. And I see that in the country. And, you know, and praying through this situation, because I dealt with a lot of emotion dealing with everything, seeing everything going on, being attacked. You know, as a law enforcement officer, people just automatically think because I have a badge and a gun that I'm out here, I'm a corrupt. You know, it's like that spirit of judgment that's on me, being a black man or a law enforcement officer. And I see it. And I also said to some other of my partners, just because you don't see the pain doesn't mean it doesn't exist.
Right.
You know, just because that you haven't experienced racism doesn't mean racism is not real.
Right.
Coming from an inner city, I seen that, it are times where I got socked up by Detroit PD. So I can see when somebody say, oh, cops are evil, they just beat me up. Mm-hmm. I see what happens, but have I done that unjustifiably or been in a situation myself personally? I have. It doesn't mean that other officers have, because there's millions of officers in the United States. With that being said, what's going on right now is just a peculiar, it's a weird time, especially with the current administration, and just it seemed like we're so far divided in every way, shape, or form that we're polarizing ourselves now. You know, where the conversation of getting to know your local police officer, or going and having a church bridge that gap and have community events is lacking now. So when the situation happens, you know, I was watching this morning where they talked about another law enforcement situation. The first thing they say, a black officer did this and a white officer did this and a black guy did that. And that's the first headline that you see.
Mm-hmm.
But why is that? Why is that the first headline? The situation with a tasing incident, you know, I've been called to situations that's similar to that. And people may not agree with me, but I believe that was a justified situation. As a police officer standpoint, going home at night, seeing that, hey, people don't understand how the taser works. They don't understand how it works. It can incapacitate you for as long as you pull the trigger, where your muscles are locked up and you can't even pull your weapon, you can't do anything. So if I'm in a fluid situation where I'm fighting with somebody pulls a taser on me, and the reason why I'm going through this is so you can kind of understand the dynamics of this situation. Not justifying anybody right or wrong, but just understand the dynamics where you have a split second to make a decision, whether you can either go home, you have to save your life, save other people's life in a matter of seconds. And some people look at it on a video and say, oh, well, this happened, that happened. Why did he do this? Why did he do that? You understand? I'm fighting for my life. And this person has pulled something that can incapacitate me and take my gun, shoot me, stump me in the head, shoot me with my own gun. I have to, at a split second, make a decision, can I shoot this person or not? That's, you know, if you guys can try to understand where that's coming from, right?
That's tough.
It's, in a matter of 5 seconds, officer, you have to make a decision.
Officer Graham, so right? Explain to me the whole Brooks situation where it escalated, but he was clearly running away from the situation. Clearly getting away from it, trying to, because he was saying to them, I want to go home anyway, just I can walk.
Right.
Why? Just let me just, you know. But it got crazy, but he clearly ran away and his back was turned to the officers. How do you justify shooting that man in the back? Because he posed no threat at that point.
I kind of disagree about posing no threat, simply because if you watch the video, and I watched it several different times, someone can pull a weapon on you and run away and point backwards at you, and you're firing a weapon, and you still they'll still get shot in the back. And people, they can put it on me, oh, he got shot in the back, got shot in the back. But if I'm pointing a weapon at you this way, and you're standing behind me, and I'm drawing my weapon this way, more than likely the rounds are gonna catch you in the back. It's different when the person is running clearly away like this,
right?
And you get shot in the back. That's a different type of situation.
But he was swinging that.
He's coming this way.
With the taser.
With the taser.
But the taser is no threat like that.
Oh, yes, it is. If I shot you with a taser right now, you would be incapacitated, locked up for 5 seconds minimum, as long as I pull the trigger.
But isn't there like a connection that goes into a person with the taser, right?
Correct. There are two different type of modes. There's a probe mode where two probes come out with mm-hmm. wires and they stick inside and they create a circuit. Okay, and the circuit then creates a pulse, 50,000 volts or so, which then takes your muscles. It's like doing 50,000 push-ups at one time. And you can't move. That's one way. The other way is called a drive stun mode, where you actually take the electricity and they put it on your right. on your body. So this situation, if those probes would have hit that officer, he would have been down for the count. He would have been, he could have got shot in the eye. It's so many different scenarios that could have happened. There's always one gun in the fight, right? The one that we bring, okay? There's always one gun. There's always a gun in take. We have multiple tools on our belt.
Right.
It's always gonna be a gun there. And I have to protect those weapons inside on my person. So if I'm incapacitated, I can't allow someone to get my gun, my taser, because you can harm other human beings with that.
Right.
Now, you know, in that different scenario, he is been fought with. It's a totality of the circumstances. It's not just,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's everything encompasses. It's the environment, what happened. He's DUI, he's now fought, he's took the taser, he's taken off running, he's shooting, and with the taser at the officer. So the totality of the circumstances,
right.
I would say that was a justified shooting. I do.
Ooh.
I would say so. I'm just being real. I'm not taking the officer's side. I'm
right.
saying, me personally, being an officer for 18 years, if I'm in that same scenario, I cannot sit here and say that I would not have done it. I can't strongly. Now, the Floyd situation is totally, everybody across the board is egregious, horrible, and it should have never happened. But this situation
is a tough one.
It's a tough one.
And you deal with tough situations like that all the time.
All the time, yes.
So just let y'all know, we are we love Brother Antonio, and he's we're on his side. He's just giving us a flip side, and we're asking him the tough questions. I'm asking mm-hmm. you the questions that people are thinking. Mm-hmm. I do agree that the situation should not have escalated. Okay. But I don't know if I necessarily agree that he should have been shot in the back.
Well,
I'm not... You know,
ballistics, you can't, you know, ballistics are ballistics. You can't, you know, if I shoot right. around and it's moving targets, you just can't argue ballistics. It's just science.
Is that the reason why most of the officers are rebelling or feel some type of way? Because from what I'm hearing from your side, that can make other officers upset that you taking down and taking away his job, taking away, because we go through tough situations like this where we have to make split decisions, and he made a decision. But my wife told me the other day that the officer had stepped on his shoulders and said, I got him. That changes the whole dynamic to me.
I didn't see
Don't
that.
Don't y'all agree?
So I didn't see that. So I can't speak to that because I didn't see that particular incidence of that. But the reason why police officers are standing tall of that, because we are here to do a job and protect the community. There's been I've contacted, I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of people on a regular basis, and majority of them go over well. But I've also fought with people. I've also been in situations where people, my partners have shot. I've been in all those different types of scenarios. We're here to do a job.
Right.
And so when you're in a scenario where the officer, if for one, haven't received any due process, the investigation's not even over with yet, right?
Right.
To put everything together, you can't tell me that the DA has all the material, all the witnesses, all the ballistics, all the coroner's reports, and say, okay, this wasn't justified, we're gonna charge him with murder. So we're saying, the law enforcement community is saying, well, wait a minute, if we do our job, now all of a sudden, all these people are getting charged, these officers are getting charged for doing something that probably 99.9% of officers would have done. That's just not, why risk my life and risk my community, my family, my home, my everything to do our job? And it's not an easy job. And we, trust me, we're not taking it, we don't want any, like we're trying to get sympathy, woe is me. We're just saying that we're doing a job to protect the public. Mm-hmm. And if we do it in a situation and something deadly happens, now all of a sudden everything is over and we're being charged for murder.
Let's talk about these white privilege arrests versus arresting a black man.
What does white privilege arrest mean?
The only way I can articulate it is that you're arresting a Caucasian person, mm-hmm. and you're giving them so much grace, the grace that we'll never see. I've seen too many times we've seen these people go crazy. Mm-hmm. I mean, get in a police car and drive off. Mm-hmm. And nobody attempts to try to shoot them or stop them. But let a black man just run away. He's shot in the back. And it's too much of it to say, well, that's just an isolated situation over there. That's an isolated situation over there. We're saying across the board is racism. Because that's the only way you can explain it. I call it white privilege arrest. Where you giving that young man grace. Like the guy who killed everybody in the church. But you took him to Burger King. But our people, you're killing them, and we're begging for our lives. So, how do you explain that?
Well, I mean, you coming to me with some generational stuff that I can't. I mean, this stuff is so
generational.
Deep. I mean, you understand? Let me explain to you. Now I'm gonna put my black man hat on right now. Okay, I teach my sons. My sons is when they have dealt and be pulled over what to do and what not to do. And I'm gonna just be real. I say there are things that are inherently in this society about black men that we are viewed, especially with the media and where we are, we're viewed as bigger, larger, stronger, violent. That's what we're portrayed in the media. And just keep it real, right?
Right.
So everybody's background is different. Okay, me coming from the city of Detroit, all black community,
right
out here, I've seen violence on every scale imaginable. My perspective of a threat is different than somebody else's perspective, okay? That's just how it is. And being a black man, we have to know that there are certain fears that people, doesn't make it right, fear about us and don't understand about us, that when we do make a move or do something, they're probably five times more scared than it would be of a person of a different race. That's just the reality of it.
Yeah.
Am I the cause of it? I can't make excuses up, but it is true. If I see, some people say, if I see a 6'4" black guy with dreadlocks, or I see a 5'10" white guy with you know what I'm saying, and they both angry at me, the size I am, I probably go sizing them up like, that guy's gonna be a problem. I probably can deal with that guy.
Right.
Just be real, right? So in these situations, everybody has a different background. We have a different background. We are trained in law enforcement to deal with certain scenario situations, but if I internally have a fear of something, when that is confronted to me, I'm gonna respond differently. And I've been in situations where I've been in the heat of the battle and I've done things that I don't even realize that I've done. You know,
right,
like, you know,
right.
Like, why did I even do that? Why did I even react that way?
Mm-hmm.
Because I know with certain things that I dealt with or have done with in my past, that may make a decision or be more precautious of certain things on a different scenario. Different officers have different background perspectives and they're gonna choose different things. I can't make a reason why.
Yeah.
I can't say it's a right privilege or it's just certain, especially when it comes with violence. Now we're talking about a ticket, as far as me giving somebody a ticket, that's some different scenario. As far as fighting somebody versus shoot and don't shoot, it's like I said, it's a totality of the circumstances that that make you want to pull the trigger, where you fear for your life versus you can take care of your business at that particular point on the ground.
I respect that. I know you have questions. Mickey Stevenson?
A couple of things that we were talking about that pops up. One is, and again, I want to say, man, your position is very unique and very special. And I'm from Detroit like you are, so I understand where you're coming from. Some of these officers, as a matter of fact, I think on every one thus far, they have had a record of being abusive and more aggressively intimidating to blacks, to the point that they enjoyed that movement. And even the guy that did the four shooting, he's got a record of doing the same thing. They have some with 18 counts. And what they would do is, and that's just just making it very mildly, when they would report them, they would transfer them to another station, another city, another. In other words, it's almost saying, I like what you're doing, but you're not getting, I can't keep you here. I got to put you over here. Whoever can make that statement and transfer is, I'm sure, is out of the category of dealing with them from your point of view as a captain or they have special groups that handle this kind of thing. And legally, they cannot put it on the record. That's one of the things we're fighting for now. Whatever you have done should be seen by anybody. They can go to your record, pull it up. Right. So you cannot go to another city, and you can go there and lie. Say, I'm a wonderful guy. So they'll bring you in. So they're saying, why are you here? Why did you leave Detroit? They don't ask that question. They're glad to have you here. Now, that's one of the things we got to change politically in voting. And those are those who are supposed to be in that position. We got to vote the right people in. It's very important. Going for the president, right, forget all that. We better vote for the politicians in our cities, different categories. We got to get them that's on the side of where we're coming from. But that's one thing. The other thing is that when you, being as gentle as you are and from your spiritual side, a lot of information would not be, if I were in charge, I would not let my cops talk with you other than stay nice. Because you represent what we want, I would want the people to look at that we are, which is not true. How could you someone be shot and they take this police officer and he stays on the force for 4 or 5 years before they even bring him to court? So that's a group and laws and rules in the upper group of the department that they can control that. You see?
Right.
Are you
with me? Tear up the country to get justice for George Floyd.
Now,
ain't that right?
Now, so I'm not holding. And man, if we had more people like you, more cops like you anywhere, this situation would be a whole nother ball game. And another thing which has always disturbed me back from even in Detroit, when they ride out to come after you, it's two or three white cops. Every now and then you'll see two whites and one black. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Why isn't it even? Because then the consciousness on both sides would always stay at a certain place of respect.
That's really good.
If they did that across the country, we'd have less of this dialogue.
Let's let up off Officer Graham just a little bit. This is a peaceful environment and loving environment. This is the church. But I do want Officer Graham to hear some of the things that you've experienced coming up. As a black man in America, what you've personally experienced with police and police brutality. If anybody in the room had any experience of dealing with some corrupt cops, let's just share with Officer Graham so he'll know.
Yeah, my name is David. I've been profiled a lot of times, but one that I can remember, I was pulling up in front of my home, and all of a sudden I hear those sirens, whoop, whoop. And I look behind me, and there's police officers just pulling behind me. They're hopping out of the car, already have guns drawn. I put my hands straight. I kept my hands on the wheel, like I've been told. You know, a lot of people, you know, tell you how to respond to these things. And my hands on the wheel. Police officers have their guns out on me, saying, "Don't move, or we will shoot." So I don't say anything. I'm just with my hands on the steering wheel. They ask me to get out the car as soon as I stand up, and I'm 6'3", and at that time I was pretty in shape, so I was like overtowering the guy, and he seemed like he got a little intimidated. grabbed me from behind, handcuffed me, and just slammed me on the front of my car. Then he searched me. I didn't have anything. Pulled me back up, and he kept saying that stop resisting. And I'm just telling him, like, just tell me where you want me to go, and I'll go that way. You know, because it was hard for me to move me around. So he puts me back in the car, back in the cop car, and I still don't know what I was pulled over for. So he finally tells me that I was pulled over because I ran a stop sign. And so in my mind, I'm like, why am I in the back of a car because I ran a stop sign? And I didn't run a stop sign. And so then he asked me, can we search your car? And I said, no. And he said, well, we're going to do it anyway. And so they searched my car, didn't find anything. And thank God that my neighbor saw the whole thing. She ran out screaming, wow, y'all can't do that. Y'all can't do that. I saw everything. Y'all, you know, she's come out screaming. And then finally, they pulled me out the car and just write me a ticket for running the stop sign. And one thing that I did, and I called my grandmother because she's active in the community and about, you know, things like this. And she told me, she said, go down to the police station and file a complaint. Filed a complaint against those officers. Got a call back later. Talked to Internal Affairs. Had an interview with them, and I explained to them everything that happened. And maybe like 2 weeks later, I got a letter saying that they're going to dismiss my ticket, so I don't have to pay the ticket. But I'm not sure what happened after that with the officers, if they got any, you know, reprimanded for it or anything like that. But, you know, I just thank God that nothing else happened, because they could have took me to jail or planted something or done something if my neighbor didn't see the whole thing to witness what just happened. So that was just my experience.
My name is Mike, and I'm going to tell pretty much what happened to me in St. Louis. I was on my way coming from work, and I got pulled over by an officer. Actually had an accident. I thought he was going to ask me if I was okay, but they asked for my license and my coworker's license. They took our license, ran everything. They found out she had a warrant in the car. So quite naturally, I grabbed the phone because she was going in the police car. She got arrested. I was calling her mom so that, you know, I could let them know that she's getting arrested. While I'm doing that, he tells me to put the phone down. I put the phone down, and then he tells me I have a right to remain silent. And he tells me to put my hand behind my back, that I'm under arrest. And I'm like, okay, I put the phone down. I follow what he tell me to do. I'm like, okay, I didn't do nothing. And so he says, well, I say, so what am I getting arrested for, sir? And so then he ends up pulling me out the car, and he ends up taking me to his car, throwing me in the car, and then he took me to the police station. They took me to a holding cell. And then when I got into the holding cell, I was asking the officers, I said, do they do this a lot of stuff? He said, oh, they left. Like, it was like, oh, we always do that.
All right, my name is Jamal. I had an experience with the officers and where I live in Palmdale, Lancaster. The police were being very corrupt. It was in the newspaper and everything. And like Mickey was saying, the corrupted police officers were shifted to a different station instead of being suspended or fired for the corruption that they were doing. But long story short, I was on the way to court for a case that I had. So they pulled me over in front of the court building. I was in a rental car. They handcuffed me, put me in the back of the car. Once I was in the back of the car, I asked them why they was pulling me over. And they said that I had a warrant for my arrest or something, but I was already on the way to court. And they said that they were towing the car and everything. So I got frustrated after that, and I'm already in the back of the police car, arrested already. So I got frustrated, and I just told them, do what you're gonna do, I don't care, just do what you want to do. So I started getting mad and giving them lip. So they came back there and maced me. I forgot what they call it, but they took my leg and pinned it in the door, and they closed the door on my leg. So by the time all this stuff was happening, I can't see. I'm worried. I'm delirious. And they threw me in the dirt, and I'm asking for a sergeant. So a sergeant came. So when the sergeant came, I'm like, why did they come back there and beat me up and do all this stuff to me just because I gave them a little lip, even though I'm already arrested? So you can't say I'm resisting arrest But the meantime, they kept saying, stop resisting, stop resisting. But I'm in the back of the police car with the door closed, in handcuffs. So how can you resist in the back of the car already? And that's it.
Well, let me just jump in real quick, because I know everybody want to share their experiences and stuff, which is great to have this dialogue. I can't sit here and in every situation justify or unjustify or any all these other. Everybody has a different their own situation that they dealt with. The one advice that I can give, which is your name, Mike, right? David, I'm sorry. David's experience, right? There is a process of a complaint process, right? See, what I tell my sons is that the fight is not on the ground, okay? You gotta understand, a lot of times we feel, especially in this climate, hey, when I get pulled over, I'm a give lip, now you're raising a situation. Some situations, you can be doing whatever, you know, you're doing what you're supposed to do, and it kind of gets out of control, and that's where the complaint process should be rendered, okay? You want to argue with somebody who has a gun to your face, right? You want to fight with somebody who has a gun or a taser to your face. You don't know what's going on, right? And you want to fight and argue, or you want to move certain, you know, say, hey, you know, you can't do that, pull away and fight, and it end up going in a bad direction. So you got to look at it as a totality of going home at night, just like the police officers do, okay? So you gotta see, how is it gonna end if you're a police officer and you come and approach me about something and I argue with you a fight, there's only a couple ways this can end, right? Either somebody get killed, right? Or there's gonna be a altercation, a fight or something like that, or somebody's gonna either get a citation or everybody's gonna go home. Okay, but at the end of the day, when that person is fighting and arguing, you now if you fight the police, instead of you just getting a warning or a citation, now you're going to get a resisting arrest. You know what I'm saying? Now you got to prove your point. Now you might even get tased or beat up and pepper sprayed. Now you're going to jail and be there for 3 days. Now you got something on your record for the arrest, even if it gets dismissed. The totality of the circumstances, it's going to not end up in your favor, regardless of how you look at it, right? So me as a black man, even now, driving in the streets, I get pulled over. It's certain things that I know I'm not gonna do, and I'm a police officer. I'm not gonna put the chance to that person. I don't know his experience. I don't know his training. I don't know anything. I'm gonna do exactly what I need to do. And if they rough me up, okay, you got me. Punch me again, because I'm gonna go right to the process, and I'm gonna get paid from the city. I'm just keeping it real. I'm gonna do, you know. So I think what I want to kind of bring it down a little bit and know that you have to understand that it's two people or maybe three or four in this situation scenario. And that everybody is evolving, and it's evolving. So whatever you bring to it is what is gonna. If you come and you amped up, the officer's gonna be amped up, especially if they already got any type of fears. So the best way that you can do is to be calm, be assertive, and try to follow directions. So that if they go outside of policy, you did everything in the right, right? You did everything in the right. We want to fight back, and we're so frustrated because, and I'm from a cop's perspective, if I pull up on somebody, they say, I've been in a situation where a robbery just happened, and it's that guy with a yellow shirt robbed this person at gunpoint. You just, right in the same scenario, right, walking home and not minding your business, and I go, and I roll up, that's the guy right there, and I jump out of the car like, hey, let me see your hands. You're like, what you stopping me for? What I'm doing? I'm like, wait, I think this person just got robbed with a gun. Right? I don't know you. You don't know me.
And he fit the description.
And he fit the description. You may say, oh, this did it because I'm black. The person who got robbed said it was a black male with a yellow shirt walking down the street and robbed me with a gun. So we're looking in the area, and you in the area fit the massive description. Yes, I'm stopping you because you fit the description. But am I solely just stopping and making this thing up? Now, I don't know if that happens. I can't justify it. I can't say it happened across the board. Cops have lied and said it happened. I'm saying in a personal scenario, if I get called to a robbery and it's a suspect in the neighborhood that you fit the description, I'm coming out with my gun and say, hey, get on the ground, be quiet, let me figure this out. Once I handcuff you and get you in the car, okay, bring the witness. Oh, that's not the guy. Hey, you know what? It was a wrong scenario. You weren't the person. You didn't get identified.
Right.
So the person that's being detained wants to fight, it can then escalate. Oh yeah, I had a legal right to come and probable cause to stop you. Now you fought, and now you made it and is resisting arrest, or you made it a fight. Now you made it assault or anything like that. Now you escalated to your record now.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? So I'm just giving you guys a little food for thought and thinking that just because you get pulled over, and I pull people over just to say, hey, you know, your brake light is out,
And as soon as I walk up to the car, what you stop me for? You stop me because I'm black. Why you pull me over? Hey, you got a tail light out. I'm trying to give you a warning, and automatically you firing off at me, and I'm just trying to give you a warning.
You know what? Don't mean to cut you off, but that's one of the common denominators of all these situations that I've noticed across the board.
Right.
There's non-compliance.
Right.
And I gotta admit to that. When I see a lot of these situations, they what you pulling me over for? Can you at least tell me? And they tell you, I'm not first giving you a license, then I'll discuss it with you. But they're not complying. I would recommend that you comply so that you can de-escalate the situation, and just don't put all the de-escalation on the officer. I'm reminded when I was arrested in Detroit for nothing. I mean, I was my car was parked, and they say your tags got it. I said, well, I was gonna get my tags fixed. No big deal. Well, I'm taking you in. You taking me in? Okay, you take me in. All right. I'm in Detroit, and we'll do this. Yes, sir. No problem. Get back there. Okay, I'm in the back. They in the front talking, and I'm saying, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's right. And the guy asked me. He said, oh, who are you? And why are you so nice? So I'm a pastor. I'm responsible for many people, and I gotta be an example.
Right.
And so, there's no reason for me to stir anything up with you and then get into a spat with you. You decided to arrest me.
Right.
But when he took me into the precinct, they say, "This is Pastor Haddon. What you doing?
Right.
What did he do? Oh, his tags. Man, get Pastor Haddon up out of here.
Right.
And you know people in these places. And so, I would recommend that everybody just comply to the best of your ability. I've even had a situation with my wife and I in Detroit again, in Royal Oak, Royal Oak, where they're shopping. And so I'm driving this big truck, got my family, my wife is pregnant, got my other two babies in the back, and we're just rolling along, and they pulled us over. And I said, all right, sir, show me your license, registration. Okay, great. Can I ask you, why did you pull me over? Well, you're driving too slow. And he said, in light of everything that's going on, you need to make sure you ain't doing nothing crazy. And I'm saying, wait a minute. And I knew at that moment, this guy's trying to provoke me. And so there is evil, Pastor Antonio, in the police department.
I'm not saying that they're angels.
They're not angels.
I didn't say they were angels.
Let's make that clear.
I want to interject and say that we all have to be responsible, okay? And one thing that frustrated me in this time is because I feel like my people, and I'm speaking to my people, the black people, that we want to, they're sending a message that because we're black, we can do whatever we want. And that's just not how the system is set up. It's not set up, and as a police officer, I can't do whatever I want. I have rules and regulations, I have laws that I abide to, and we have to be responsible for our own well-being. We have to be responsible for our families, we have to be responsible as men, and we have to be responsible. So how are we gonna change our communities? We gotta do it ourselves. We can't depend on the police. Oh, it's police brutality. It's all the cops. Okay, well, let's talk. Let's have these conversations. Let's black men get together and figure out what we can do to keep ourselves, safe on the streets. Let's have these conversations about our families. How can we break the chain, break that curse?
Right.
We need to do all that together collectively, because if we do it collectively, then guess what? There'll be less police involvement. There'll be less broken homes. The church is thriving, we're thriving, and we can then raise our families up and our communities up on a higher level. Well, we don't need someone from the outside to intervene into our family. So I think we just need to be responsible for ourselves, and police officers need to be responsible for what they need to do, and we all need to work collectively together to make this thing better.
Okay, I have one last question. We'll be here all day with this, because this is a serious matter in our culture right now. And it's something that we're all concerned about, because we're seeing it, we're living it every single day. I have one last question for you, Officer Graham, is that as an officer of the law, is there a struggle between your duty to your badge and your emotions as a black man? Do you have a struggle between your duty to your badge and your emotions as a black man, and seeing what other black men and women are going through right now in the culture?
It's interesting, because when I first became a police officer, I was just finished. I was just really getting into my faith,
I was struggling with being on the streets and being a Christian, and then the law enforcement, it was a struggle for me, because I when you become a new Christian, you think everybody's good, everybody holy, you know, right? You get you know what I mean? You like, and then you start realizing, man, these church folks is worse than these people of the world, right? You're like, what's going on, right? So it's like, right? They mistreated me just as well as everybody, right? So in the beginning, when I became a officer, that struggle was very deep for me, because I would arrest people and deal with people, and then I'd be like, man, you know, I wanted to give them another chance. But then I started maturing a little bit in my faith and realizing that I'm a child of God and God is using me in His field. I had a situation where I was in contact with a lady. She was strung out on heroin. I didn't even remember ministering to this lady at all. She ran into her like 5 years later. She was strung out, boyfriend was beating her up, whatever. She came up, I was at the gas station. She was like, Officer Graham, I just want to thank you. You know, I know you're a Christian, you're a man of God, and I thank you for, you know, for being the way that you were to me. And she had turned her life around. I'm off drugs and all this other stuff. And I'm like, wow. And that happened a few years back. And just recently, it was a guy, he was a black guy. He was a crackhead. And he used to smoke dope right outside the church doors. And it infuriated me. So every night I was to go over there and arrest this guy with a pipe. I knew he had it. Every night, I mean, I was on him. On his case. I said, I'm going to make him my mission. I arrested this guy probably 15 times. Give him tickets, take him to jail. And so I went to the bank. This actually happened like 2 months ago. I went to the bank in a city that not where I work. And I'm walking through the bank parking lot, and this guy comes up. And he's like, Officer Graham, I remember you. He had on a security guard outfit. He was clean, gained weight. And I'm like, and I called his name. He was like, yeah. He's like, I just, you know, I got my life clean. I'm working now. I'm off drugs. Wow. And, you know, and I just want to thank you, Officer Graham. I want to thank you. And it brought me emotion, because every contact that I had with him was a building block for Jesus to do his work.
Wow.
And so me taking him to jail was part of his ministry of God, his deliverance, right? So then I start saying, wow, I'm me holding the law and he even knew I was a man of God. I don't know how these people, I guess it just zooms out my spirit or whatever, but they coming to me and saying, you know, wow, I thank you for doing what you did. And I just was like, wow, it just messed me up. So that's why I came here today, because it's my duty to continue to spread a light in these dark times that people don't understand, and saying that, you know, anybody want to call me and talk to me and mentor. I mentor youth. I do it all. But, you know, I think to collectively, if we continue to plug away and know that we are important, our lives are valuable. Amen. You know, God loves us just as well as everybody, and that we have a standard not only to God, but as a young man, they're saying that we have to spread the light upon the world. And so if my light spreads upon my department and other officers to the light of Jesus, even when I'm in contact with you on the streets, and even if you as a citizen, you contact me and you spread your light to me, because it's a two-way street, we can all make a difference. Are we going to solve the problems overnight? No, we're not.
Right.
But it's always a work to be done, you know?
Okay, brethren, let's give Officer Graham a hand for coming to hang out with us and having this tough conversation. It wasn't easy. But he handled it like a champ. And we appreciate you, man. We are covering you. We appreciate you being a man of faith in such a system where there is some corruption, but you're holding on to your faith. We appreciate that, man. And we're praying for you and your family and your ministry. He's a man of God, so we're going to give you the opportunity to close us out in a word of prayer. And let's bow our heads, brethren, and let's receive this prayer from Officer Graham.
Lord, we just humbly come to you today. With all humbling grace and mercy, Lord, we just ask this evening, this conversation today, that we don't close our eyes and our hearts and our ears to hear what you have to say in this time, that these conversations can even spark a light and allow the Holy Spirit to soften those hearts that are hardened in the way of justice, injustices, and the things that are occurring in these streets. Lord, I just pray for the nation as a whole, that as a man of God, that I can come and ask you to just have some grace and mercy in these times. That as you bring peace into the hearts and the homes of all men. And especially that in the season where the black men and black people are just feeling so disenfranchised and so taken advantage of and so unappreciative. Lord, I just ask you wrap your arms around this nation, and that you bring your spirit upon all men, and that we will definitely come and know that you are the God of, you are the Redeemer, you are the healer. So we just ask that you heal this nation, Lord, that you heal these hearts of these men that are struggling and just struggling with the pay their bills and just figuring out if they can make food for their families, Lord. If they're the right fathers and they're the right husbands and they're the right brothers, I just ask that you put the spirit of excellence over them and know that they are sons of God, that they can walk in true righteousness. And I pray for the police departments right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. I pray that you can guide their hands and guide their hearts and guide their morals and their ethics, and Lord, that you can just heal any hurt and any type of animosity or any prejudgment on anyone, Lord. I just ask that you wipe the slate clean, heal this land, and that you bring us together in the name of Jesus. Lord, that you bring the churches together in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. That you can bring all of us together to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord. Hallelujah. I just pray over the men in the room right now in the name of Jesus. As many men that spoke this morning and said that they grew up without a father. Yes, and we know if they grew up without a father, that they have the spirit of abandonment upon them. That they are in competition with not only themselves, but the spirit of abandonment that make them feel less of a father, less of a man. I just pray and rebuke it in the name of Jesus. That these men are powerful. Glory. They are mighty. They are valuable. And that they can be strong fathers and have raised strong children. And I just pray over them right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I just ask that you cover us as we come and we travel. Keep us safe on the roads. Keep our families healthy. I rebuke any spirit of sickness over anyone that's dealing with any ailments right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I just pray anointed over this church. Let Hill City be the light in this LA area and breaking it to the East Coast, to the West Coast, to the North, to the South, Lord, that it be used in a mighty way. Glory. That you keep the fire and the conviction in this place. Let the Holy Spirit run free in this place and run rampant, Lord. You give Pastor Deitrick the anointing and the vision to stand strong. Yeah. Protect his marriage and his children, Lord. Let him stay holy and righteous and stand true on the word of God.
Yes,
Lord. I pray for this ministry right now that you can bring it into overflow and you can bring and mentor people and send them out to the land.
So
I thank you right now. Let it rise up, the sons of God, and take authority in this land.
Hallelujah.
And make peace in the name of Jesus, that we can go forth in true victory.
Hallelujah.
That there be no more division, and only we can say, holy, 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 God Almighty, you as was and is and is to come. So I thank you right now for this session. Let us be healed in the name of Jesus. I thank you this
Hallelujah.
Day. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Hallelujah. I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord. Hey, hallelujah. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord.
My God. My God, my God. What a time we've had together in sharing man to man the state of the black man in America. Officer Graham have shared some great insight for us. We are leaving this session enlightened with understanding, and we're educated in the things on the other side. Sometimes we don't see outside of ourselves, and we were able to see from an official officer, from his perspective. But right now, it's not about me. It's not about him. It's not about us. It's about you. Lift your hands. Let's get you saved. Let's stretch our hands toward the camera, brethren. Repeat after me, say, Father, I'm a sinner. And without your help, come on,
I'll
remain a sinner.
Forgive me
of my sins.
Sins of omission.
Sins of commission.
Sins we know.
Sins we don't know.
We
thank you
for your forgiveness.
I believe
that
you died on the cross and you
rose again
on the third day
for
my sins. Come into my mind.
Come
into my heart. Take ownership of my soul. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Give God praise, everybody. Welcome into the family. If you don't have a church home, you are more than welcome to come and join Hill City Church. We're located at 550 West Manville Street in Compton, California, and we love people. It's a church full of real people seeking a real God, and there's no place to be than at Hill City Church. I'm telling you, it's a wonderful place to be. And so God bless you. Thank you for hanging out with us, and we're going to continue to have these conversations. We're not going to stop until we see change across the land in Jesus' name. And not only are we protesting, but we're praying in the spirit on behalf of our nation. Continue to pray, brothers and sisters, and we will see a change in Jesus' name. All right, fellas, let's give the Lord a hand praise one more time. God bless you. Be blessed.
Let me see if y'all remember this one.
Yeah. What's going on? I know you would like this one, Mickey.
Mother, mother, that's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's too many of you dying. You know we gotta find a way to bring some loving here today. Oh, 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 oh. Father, Father, there's no need to escalate. My, my, my. War is not the answer. Only love can conquer. Dying, run, run.
lost too many of us crying. You know we gotta find a way to bring some love in here today. Whoa.
Today's presentation is brought to you by Hill City Church.